Okay, well, I'm Michelle Naranjo. I'm the editor-in-chief of Autobytel, and we are at the LA Auto Show, and we're in the Nissan booth. We have several things we're going to do today. I've got some of the writers with me. Dan does video for us, of course, Dan Gray, and Benjamin Hunting, and Joni Gray. We're also going to be interviewing some people from, we're going to have someone to come and talk about the Viper. We're going to talk about some of the Nissan products that are here. Some other special guests are going to stop by, and then we're going to talk a little bit about what we've seen at the show, what our favorite things are, or maybe our least favorite things are even. Dan?
Favorite things? I just did a back-to-back with a Tesla Model S and the BMW i3. I only was able to ride along in the Tesla Model S, but I was able to drive the i3 for about 15 minutes or so around downtown LA. And I have to say, the difference between the two cars is pretty pronounced, specifically within the interiors. The Tesla doesn't feel like a luxury car when you look at the materials and the design. It's nice, but it's not BMW level, it's not Audi level. It's a lovely car, but driving the i3, awesome. This maybe is the best extended range electric yet. But I've only been in it for 50 minutes, so it's a
lead. What was it like inside in terms of room? Like, is it a two-person car, or is it something that, you know, a family could conceivably drive?
So this is the...
Well, it has the split doors, right?
Yeah, so I don't know about you, but I'm a sucker for suicide doors. Anything with suicide doors, I'm
you
there.
You can't call them suicide doors anymore, though, can you?
Well, he just did, so we're going to have to censor that out.
He used to call it the Freedom Door.
Freedom Door? That's
just
a scary...
It's just wide open. When you open the doors up, you can see all the exposed carbon fiber. It's breathtaking, and it's really, really, really different.
But you didn't answer my question. What's the room like inside? Like, if I have kids in the back seat, kids that are, I guess, conceivably my kids, whoa. Are they going to be complaining? And at what age do you have to say, okay, we're not taking the i3 anymore, we're taking something bigger?
I didn't fit myself into the back, so I didn't have time to do that. So, but maybe I'll do that
it's
on the way back.
It's pretty small.
Pretty small?
It's pretty small. It's like a compact car, but not a super roomy compact car.
Okay.
It's really sportier, and that's what I like about it than, say, the Leaf or another e-car. But the coolest thing about it is it has that, I call it the cheese board.
Oh, the bamboo piece and the dash.
It's very cool.
Yeah. It's eucalyptus.
It's a beautiful piece of wood that is kind of flat, and you can just, you know, serve some nice brie on it or something.
So you can have hors d'oeuvres in your car.
I mean, I would, but maybe others would. It's a very cool car, and some people say it just isn't BMW enough looking. It's too, you know, electric car looking, but I think it's awesome looking.
What does that mean, it's not BMW enough?
Maybe not sporty enough.
It's not following the DNA. It's a crossover.
Yeah, somebody told me, I think it was Lieberman or somebody told me that you look at that, it's got a BMW badge, but that is the only thing telling you it's a BMW.
Well, I think it's interesting that people would say that, given that if you look at we saw the i8 yesterday, which is ostensibly the i8 and the i3 are part of the same lineage. It's the idea is BMW's new mobility push towards electric cars. But those vehicles could not be more different from a style perspective. Mm-hmm. And to say that the i3 doesn't look like a BMW, well, the i8 doesn't really look like a BMW either. It looks like the future of BMW, which I think is potentially what we're seeing with the i3 as well. And
yes.
It's hard for people to recognize that break, and it's not necessarily a continuous evolution of style like we've seen with the 3 and the 5 and the 7, which are very similar looking cars now compared to how they were, say, 15 years ago.
Yeah.
So I kind of applaud BMW for having the guts to break with what they have now and try something almost entirely new yet still attractive to the eye. So, I mean, you like it, you like it, and it looks nothing like a current BMW sedan.
I agree, 100%.
So, you want to grab our first guest?
Yeah, we're ready. I'm out.
Yeah, sure. We'll bring you back in a little bit. So, TJ, who's first?
Thanks.
Hi. Hi. Michelle, Benjamin, and
Benjamin, Jody. Nice to meet you.
Hi, nice to meet you.
So Mark Trussell is going to talk to us. And Dan Reed's popping in.
I just want to pop in because I walked away and I said, why, what if Michelle, because there's a TA, there's a Viper TA.
The TA in the GTS.
Right.
Yes.
So if the TA, we don't have here.
Yeah, we noticed that. We were a little disappointed because we're very excited to see it.
Are you?
Yes.
Okay. Well, I've got a USB if you need images or any type of information, I can give it to you. But Mark can certainly talk to the product design side of it.
Okay.
And if we get too technical, that's where, I mean, I don't want to know, or I don't want to go too deep into, you know, suspension measurements.
Well, Mark can just slap the table and get out of here, and we'll take that. Exactly.
It's a live stream. Exactly. Anything goes.
So I just wanted to make sure that we knew TA versus GTS.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yep. Carbon. Okay.
Awesome. So we're going to talk.
We figured that.
We can talk both of them.
Yeah. Okay. But TA first, I guess, because it's, you know, it's kind of what you're pushing right now. So it's the new available to, I understand they're only making, you said 33 that are going to be available?
93 orange, 33 white, and 33 black.
Okay. And is it going to be primarily aimed at club racers or people who do high performance driving events? I mean, what's the market for the TA versus the GTS?
Yeah, exactly. You just answered it. Yeah, it's that customer that does a lot of the weekend, you know, track events.
Okay.
You know, really wants to get the most performance out of the vehicle as opposed to the you know, back road driving or the, you know, we have a lot of customers that actually drive them every day as well. So, yeah, it's certainly for the more hardcore enthusiasts.
So it is street legal. It's just...
Oh, yeah absolutely. Yep. Yeah.
And the improvements are mostly underneath the skin. It's a lot of chassis stiffening, and I think it's a larger swept area for the brakes.
Yeah, the guys work closely with Brembo, different Brembo big brake package on there. The aero package has 7 times the downforce that the normal car has. So top speed's affected a little bit on it, but, you know, the trade-off is obviously the downforce that you get on it. And then they've done some things with the sway bars as well to, you know, make the car a little stiffer in that. So in camber, you know, suspension settings and that. So things that, you know, make it a little more hardcore than the GTS.
And are we looking at greater adjustability for aero and camber, or is it more kind of a set from the factory?
It's the guys have really, you know, optimized it. Okay. Certainly there's a lot of enthusiasts that like to play with, you know, camber and things on their own, but from an aero standpoint, the car will be, it comes with the splitters on the front and the spoiler on the back, and we spent hours in the wind tunnel developing that, so it's really kind of optimized.
Cool.
And what's the, if someone's looking at a GTS versus a TA, what kind of pricing difference are they looking at? I mean, where does it fall in the pantheon of, you know, Viper, GTS, TA, is that the order?
We've got the SRT, then GTS, and TA falls, you know, in the, probably in the middle between SRT and GTS.
And it does, I'm assuming it doesn't have the same kind of luxury accoutrement that are in the,
correct,
available with the GTS?
The ballistic cloth seats in it. Okay. You know, you can't get leather, but we still have done some things, you know, the orange that we have on all three colors, we've accented that throughout the interior, so we have an orange stitch on the interior to set it apart a little bit as well, a unique badge. What we find with our customers, Viper customers, is they like these low volume special models that we build. The TA falls into that, so we really try and make each one of them have its own soul, if you will. So the TA is certainly performance.
Are they going to have the number on the dash? Like,
I believe, you know what, I shouldn't say because I can't recall right now how we're numbering them.
And it's going to be 2014 model year only.
2014.
Now, the car people are going to come into the LA Auto Show this week to see here, the GTS.
It's beautiful.
Oh, my gosh. You got it.
You can't take a picture of it because you have to see it in person.
It's fabulous. And the paint is, what is that all about? How did you get
there? We're really proud of that. And we, you know, we look at, obviously, especially in Southern California, the matte paint trends that have been around for years in the aftermarket, if you will. And, you know, there's been a few OEMs that have done some small packages of it. Obviously, there's a lot more maintenance and care that needs to go into a low gloss or a matte paint. But with the Viper, our customers, you know, those are the people that really, you know, the cars are really special and they probably take extra care to them. So we had been playing around with developing a matte paint to use in production. And we thought this was a great place to use it. So we have the GTS model over there, and we call it anodized carbon. And it has a lot of, you know, you see a lot of matte paints, and they end up looking chalky to me. They don't have a lot of what I call travel. Or, you know, even though they're matte, you still like to have some reflection.
Yeah, absolutely.
So we put a lot of metallic in it and played with the gloss level. So when you see it over there, it's matte, but it's still, it's just the sculpture on the hood, everything lights up on it really well. So
I noticed you're not going to let people get in there and put their hands on it.
Yeah. Funny, everybody, it's funny you mention that, because everybody wants to touch that paint, because you're used to seeing shiny things and you know what that feels like, but with that, everyone wants to
put
the grease prints on it.
It's like the Chia pet of paint. So
it's beautiful and really worth seeing, just admiring, just like a sculpture.
Yes. Actually, it's a rolling sculpture.
That's exactly what it is.
It's breathtaking.
Thank you.
Anything else on the racing front that you want to know, Benjamin?
I know that you had a very good season this year in the LMS series. And next year, I mean, I know that there's a lot of changes going on with road racing in the United States. And do you know anything? Can you talk a little bit about SRT's efforts? What kind of campaign we're going to be seeing next year? And are we going to see the same teams and drivers coming back, hopefully?
I don't have all the background on the, you know, the drivers, where we stand with that. My role in the car was actually, which was great, was as we were developing the new Viper, 2013 Viper, within my design studio, we were also working with Riley and designing the exterior of the race car. So it was cool to be to actually be designing both of those at the same time. And I think it's the reason our race car looks as good as it does, is that we did work closely with
engineering
to do it. So just a little side note on that. But I know that the team, you know, they're working really, really hard to, you know, have a great, great year next year, I will say that.
Great. It's good to hear. Well, thanks for taking the time, and really appreciate it.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, and we'll see you in Detroit, I'm sure.
Yeah, great. All right.
Thanks. Appreciate it. Sure. Take care.
Okay.
Cool. I don't know who we have next. We have a surprise, I think. Hi.
Hi.
Tim Philpott with Jaguar.
Nice to meet you, Tim. Nice to see you. Are we going to talk about that exciting car?
Well, I thought we could talk about Range Rovers instead.
Okay.
I am the product manager for the F-Type, so I would love to talk to you guys about the F-Type and the F-Type Coupe.
Well, we all were there for the big reveal.
Was that not amazing?
Everyone I talked to said it was the best reveal they've ever seen, and me included, and it's because you actually, I'm curious to ask you, how fast did the car, was it going when it went underneath the audience? The car came down from an acre or so away, straight towards the audience.
Everyone thought the car was going to stop. We had Tommy Kendall in the audience. He's done some work for us. So he's a professional race car driver. So he was looking. He's like, oh, I know what they're going to do. He's just going to come to a screeching halt right in front of the stands, and it's going to be amazing. And he's like, he's not slowing down.
That moment never arrived.
He's like, he missed his breaking point. Well, this is not going the way I thought it was going to go. But he was doing almost 90 miles an hour by the time it went underneath the stands.
90. I guessing lower.
Where he went underneath the stands, that's where we were just minutes before. That's where the bar was. So he drove between the bar. They opened up a section of the hangar outside, and he came to a stop outside the building.
Because we didn't hear the brakes.
Yeah.
No. That was really
not that we could hear much over the exhaust note. Anyway.
Yeah. The idea was to make it the world's fastest reveal, and I think that was the fastest anyone's got in a car on
stage.
And
also, that is a famous soundstage that you were at,
it
right?
It is Raleigh Studios. Yeah.
And the sound was also amplified. I mean, it was... Mm-hmm. It sounded just as dramatic as it
was. When I first heard the helicopters, I live here in
LA. Where do you live, Michelle?
I live in Long Beach. Yes. But it's LA County. And I said to Dan Gray, who's from New York, oh, welcome to LA.
LA.
I thought it was just a normal day in LA.
That was all fake. Yeah. Everyone thought those helicopters were real. It was just lights on cranes outside the windows, and then the speakers under the stage just shaking.
But all this is about the F-Type Coupe and the F-Type Coupe. Well, that's a big argument.
So I do call it the F-Type Coupe. If we were having this conversation in England, it would be the Jaguar Coupe. But I am from New York, so it is a coupe.
Okay. But it's still Jaguar.
It is, if you want to be properly British about it.
Jaguar.
I feel a little pompous when I say
that. Well, it's a fabulous car, and tell us more, about that.
So the convertible came out. We had it at the Los Angeles Auto Show exactly a year ago. In Fire Sand Orange, you might have remembered that. And it really captured the hearts of people, and they're just like, that is amazing, it's beautiful, and it captured the heritage of what Jaguar is about. We have a long history of making sports cars, you know, the C-Type, the D-Type, the E-Type, and so to come out with the F-Type, it had to live up to that legacy, and we're really proud of what we've achieved with that, because like, customers, press alike are saying, that is amazing, but then everyone kept saying, you really need to come out with a coupe, and I'm thinking, well, a year before that, did you see the CX-16 concept car that we did? Yeah, that would be good, wouldn't it? The coupe has remained so true to that CX-16 concept car. It is almost identical. Probably the only change, the concept car, the hatch opened sideways like the E-Type, and there was just no practical way to do that, because if you do that, all your luggage gets wet when you open it up in the rain. So apart from the direction that the hatch opens up, the look is identical. So we even have a car in white with a red interior, just like we had with the CX-16 2 years ago. But what the coupe does for us is it more than doubles the market penetration of the F-Type. The U.S. is the largest sports car market in the world. California alone is probably outranks every other country in the world. But there are a lot of people that want the more performance-oriented body style, so they want that hard roof so they can take it out on the racetrack. There's a little more structural integrity, a little more rigidity, so that you can just tune the suspension a little more. So it allows you to go after that more performance-oriented customer, but it also allows you to go after the customer that's looking for a little more practicality, because you can fit one set of golf clubs in the convertible, you can fit two in the coupe, right? So it's almost like 30-40% more luggage space. So you're capturing people on both ends of the market, the people that want to go really fast with 550 horsepower, the people that like the design and the style of the F-Type, that wanted something that would fit a little more luggage, you know, two sets of golf clubs that you go with their partner out to the golf course. So the performance-minded, the enthusiast-minded, and it really kind of, it broadens the spectrum of who the F-Type appeals to.
So will the F-Type convertible ever get an R?
That is a great question.
Isn't everyone asking?
It is. There's a couple of questions that are just, you know you're going to get.
Well, people are never satisfied, right? It always has to be something more. The car is great, but could it be better?
And there's a reason why we waited to do the R. And there's also a reason why we waited with the coupe. You want to have a cadence of products that comes out. You want to have a reason for people to come back to the show, see more, come back into the dealerships, and always have something exciting and new to show. So that's why we staggered the convertible and then the coupe. And we thought the coupe body style was the best car to introduce the R on, because it's the most performance-oriented body style, and it's the one that could handle the 550 horsepower the best. So while I cannot comment on future products, you knew that was coming, right?
Yes.
While I cannot comment on future products, I can say that we have a really exciting cadence of things for the F-Type coming up. So keep coming back to the LA Auto Show next year or the year after, because there will be something new and fun to see every year.
And I'm curious as to what the F-Type Coupe means for the XK.
You know, that's a great question, because they really sit alongside the showroom very well together. The XK is a larger car.
Yes.
It is a more luxurious car. It is a more practical car in many respects. The XK is really the definition of a grand touring car. You know, the idea of a grand touring car is you can travel at high speed, but in great comfort and exceptional style. So you can, you know, start your trip in the morning in Paris and be at the south of France in time for, you know, for lunch with your, you know, with your beautiful model wife, right? Because that's the grand touring lifestyle. And you fit all of your luggage. You arrive looking relaxed and comfortable, right? The F-Type, you do that same journey, and your ears are ringing from, you know, opening up the exhaust through all the tunnels and the passes on the way down.
Absolutely.
And, you know, the wind in your hair, and you might need a little freshening up by the time you get there. They're really different kinds of cars. One is a true sports car, and one is a grand touring car. And what we found is that in some markets, XK sales have gone up by 20% because of the added interest in the brand. Mm-hmm. So people have been intrigued by the F-Type, coming into the showroom and saying, that is beautiful, I love the way it sounds and drives, but I want just a little more luxury or just a little more room. So that 2+2 seating of the XK makes a difference for some customers, you know, to at least be able to pretend that you can put humans in the back seat or have a little more room for your luggage.
And really, Jaguar hasn't had a sports car since 1961 that can truly be called a sports car.
Yeah, the E-Type was the last real sports car, because after the E-Type we had the XJS, which, you know, was V12 powered and actually could outrun a Corvette at the time, but it was still a grand touring car. It was still large, it was still luxurious. So grand touring doesn't mean slow, but it does mean that extra level of luxury and practicality.
Yes. And there's a whole generation alive now buying cars who never ever thought of Jaguar as a sports car company, although
it is an entirely new audience for us. That And I feel I've been fortunate enough to drive a lot of the F-Type convertibles around. I've put thousands of miles around them on the racetrack. I live in New York City, so around Manhattan. Everywhere I go, the car gets attention. People are pointing, staring. We did an event in the city, and a gentleman came up to me. He's about 80 years old, and he just wanted to tell me about his 1953, I think it was XK120, the first car that he had out of the service. You know, and he was just wildly in love with this car. And then I've had it parked on the street and had, you know, a group of skater punks walk by, and they're just like saying words that I can't say, you know, in public to describe it. And I had to ask my friend, is that good? How do you just describe my car?
It's good.
Yeah. And so it's appealing to this really broad spectrum. The people that never would have looked at a Jaguar been, you know, they're saying that this is the first Jaguar that has really made them notice the brand. And what's great is we've gotten the rest of the portfolio into a place where it appeals to people. So now that the F-Type is drawing them in, some people are noticing the XJ for the first time. They're noticing the XF for the first time because we are a very small company. And that's, you know, there's a benefit and a downside of that. The benefit is you don't see yourself coming and going, right? You don't walk out to the parking lot and have to hit the panic button to see which, you know, silver German luxury car is yours. You know yours is the Italian Racing Red XJR, right? It stands out. But at the same time, people can go, you know, weeks or months without seeing one on the road. When they do, it's an event. I've had a couple of XK coupes in a row as company cars. And my wife knows whenever we walk out of a store, there's someone standing there, and they start the conversation by saying, nice car. She just knows she goes back into the store for 20 minutes because it's going to be a conversation, right? And it's the people that are intrigued by the cars that just, they're really kind of rediscovering the Jaguar brand for the first time. And that's why you do something like a sports car. Mm-hmm. Sports car sales are about 1% of the overall car market. Mm-hmm. So that's not really going to impact your bottom line that much.
It definitely impacts your image.
Are even less.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah. So for every, you know, out of 15 million cars sold this year, you know, 1% will be convertibles. You do it for the impact on the brand and for the attention that you get from the press. And it's been overwhelmingly positive. The stories, the headlines, we couldn't have scripted them better ourselves because it's people connecting with the car in a pure, kind of raw, emotional way.
Can you address how, I just have noticed that it didn't have voice activation. Is there any lack of technology that maybe your competitors are, how do you address
that? Yeah, I mean, it's most of the other Jaguars have voice control. With the top down and with the sound of the exhaust, they found that voice control actually was probably not the most effective way to interact.
Well, you're paying attention to driving, you know.
And you've got the sound.
Yes.
They have a sound in it that is so loud and crackling.
It does.
It's amazing.
It is. The sound, and I tell people when I drive this car, I've driven it around the Circuit of the Americas, which is probably the best racetrack in America right now, and I've driven it around Manhattan. And I can say that I have just as much fun driving on a racetrack as I do driving around Manhattan, which sounds ridiculous, right? But it's a sports car. If a car only works on the racetrack, you've made a race car, not a sports car. Right? Yeah. It has to work in the real world. And so on the track, you know, you're opening up and you're pushing the envelope. But around Manhattan, in those concrete canyons and going through the Lincoln Tunnel, the sound.
Oh. It's the visceral experience of driving the car.
Listening to it echo. So even in first gear at 20 miles an hour, you're having the time of your life in that car. And that's to me, is the sign of a really good sports car, something that's fun to drive everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Well, really appreciate you coming by to talk to us.
It's been
great.
It's, you know, it's a great car.
It's a beautiful car. Yeah. Congratulations on that.
Well, thank you for having me. It was
coupe
a pleasure.
Coupe.
However you want to pronounce it, it's all in how you drive it. Mm. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye.
Hey. Love it is a beautiful car. You know, some people are saying, is it that beautiful like the E-Type? But it's gorgeous.
Yeah.
Am I in tight enough?
You are in. You are in, and we are in the sports car. It is the LA Auto Show, so it is all about sports cars.
Absolutely.
It's Chad.
Yes. Hi, guys.
How are you? I'm sorry.
I'm coming across. There it is.
Benjamin.
Hi, Benjamin.
Joni, good to see you.
Tell me your name again.
Joni.
Joni and Michelle. Okay, mm-hmm. Great. Awesome. I'm excited to be here. We've got a lot of exciting products on the floor.
Yeah, we're sitting around. We're sitting surrounded by them right now.
Absolutely.
So.
I like to call it Nismo Row. I nicknamed it that because all of the vehicles up here are Nismo tuned. So very exciting. The Z, which is actually available for purchase right now in the United States, has 350 horsepower. That's naturally aspirated, so no turbos there. Don't need one. Over here, we're up to 215 horsepower on the... This is the Juke Nismo RS. So we recently released the Juke Nismo. This is a step up from that. And it's up to 215 horsepower. It's got the six-speed manual transmission in it that actually is related to the manual transmission we used to have in our Maxima. You guys probably know we don't have the manual transmission in the Max manual.
It's just a CVT now, I believe.
It is. You're exactly right, sir. So it's got paddle shifters in the Max.
It's the second generation CVT, right?
Yeah.
It is. Yeah. Yeah. It's the one that's in the Maxima hasn't been redesigned in a few years, but we have a lot of next-generation CVTs on the floor.
Pathfinder, Rogue.
Yes, exactly correct. Yep, there you go. So all of those are very, very fuel efficient. I'm pretty sure that all of those are actually... No, before I say it, I don't want to shoot myself in the foot, but they're if they're not the best in class miles per gallon, fuel economy-wise, then they're very, very close to it. And so not only do you get the 6-speed manual here as an option with the front-wheel drive, on the Juke Nismo RS, you actually get the CVT, but with paddle shifters now as well. So that's a really cool option. That's on the all-wheel drive version. So it's either manual with the front wheel drive or the CVT with the all-wheel drive. And I haven't even driven one of the Nismo versions yet, but even the base...
Aren't you Nismo?
I'm supposed to, right? Yeah. But Nissan does a great job of actually training us every year, but they don't always have access to all of the vehicles. I keep drooling over and begging for the GTR to come to training, and I actually have driven one before.
Well, that's kind of the big Magilla in the room here. That thing, it's unbelievable.
It is.
It's unbelievably fast.
It is. Yesterday was an amazing day for us because it was the North American debut for the GTR Nismo, and that baby's got 600 horsepower, 481 pound-feet of torque, and yeah, it set a GTR production GTR record around the Nürburgring Nordschleife at 7 minutes and 8 seconds, just over that, skosh over that. So it... it's right up there with the best in the world, and you know, for hundreds of thousands less. I mean, you guys probably know the competition, and so why pay all that money when you can just get a GTR?
Well, speaking of why pay all that money, I'm also curious about the Sentra Nismo that's behind us now, because Sentra, there was a time when you could get an SER, and it was a spec fee, and it was the hot ride, and it's been that was a long time ago, and now we have a new Sentra.
Yes.
As of this year, yes. 2013 was the model year, I believe. And
you're correct.
So, I know it's not in production yet. I'm assuming it very well might be, but let's say it was in production. What would we be looking at? Like, what makes the Nismo Sentra special?
Great question. So, not only do you get the track-tuned suspension, just like in the other vehicles, but we're talking about over here you have the track-tuned steering, additional boost. Obviously, there's a ton more power. The biggest jump in anything that you'll be able to notice right off the bat is, of course, the turbo that's under the hood, because it's normally a 1.8 liter putting out 130 horsepower. Now, not production yet, as you mentioned, but as the concept, 240 horsepower with a turbocharged 1.8 liter. So that's the biggest jump. But you can see right behind us here, actually, it's got the red pinstriping that is you'll find in all Nismo vehicles.
You'll see it on all the vehicles.
Yeah, but it's very aggressive as far as the aerodynamics. It's a little lower to the ground, larger wheels and tires. And so that's something that you'll find is common with all of the Nismos.
It may end up on our 10 sexy dad cars someday.
You know what? I'm not even a dad yet, and I'll take it right now.
I mean, with that kind of power, that puts you back into the conversation that you haven't been a part of in a long time. And it's nice, too, to see that it's 240 and not 200.
Right.
Because that would kind of keep you on the outside looking in. But with 240, you're right there with the Focus ST and, to some degree, the WRX and the cars that the Mazda Speed, the GTI, the cars that are, you know, leading that compact sport performance pack. Mm-hmm. So, I would be happy to see it in production. I've driven the Nismo Juke. The last year's model, and I enjoy it. I mean, I love the styling, and it's a very fun vehicle in every sense of the word.
It looks great as a sporty car.
It does.
I'm glad you guys said that, the fun factor, because to me, not only does it look cool, I mean, I love the front fascia. I mean, you know, going back to the 50s and 60s rally cars, I mean, some people, and at Nissan, you know, we have the bold designs. You guys know that. It's not...
Well, you're one of the few companies that's not afraid to bring something over from the JDM market.
Right.
And say, all right, let's see how it works. Yeah. And you have this, you have the Cube, you have a history of doing that, and I appreciate that. And I know it's not for everyone, but that doesn't need to be sold to everyone. You have a big lineup.
Exactly right. I mean, it's doing very well here in the United States, and it's doing amazing over in Europe as well. I mean, just the fun factor, once again, is through the roof. It's not the fastest car that you'll ever drive, but it offers plenty of quickness. I mean, for everyday driving. I mean, and so it really, really is. As soon as I hopped in one, it brought a smile to my face. I mean, and that, to me, that is an important factor in the car buying decision making process.
And it's practical too. Yeah. I mean, for two people, yep. It's a stretch to call it a family car, but for two people, you can haul someone every once in a while if you need to in the back. But you got a decent amount of cargo room, mm-hmm. and you can still park it. It's a unique spot to be in the market. And
I like to call it our sport compact crossover. So it gives you the performance and handling of a sports car, the fuel economy of a compact, because the base model is 27 in the city and 32 on the highway. Yeah. And I mean, that's pretty amazing for 188 horsepower. That's the stock version.
And it's still fun to drive in
it
the
really
base
is.
Model.
Yeah.
You don't have to go for the RS or the Nismo if you don't want to. It's still the chassis and the platform. Mm-hmm. It's got a lot of smiles in there.
Yeah.
It is.
Fold down those rear
very
seats. Fun. Put your gear back there. Yeah. No problem. Yeah. It's really is cool. I got a dog, so dog in the back, no sweat.
Perfect. So I know the 370, mm-hmm. it's been around for a while.
Yes.
I know you can't really talk about future product in any detail, but is there a chance that we might be seeing a next generation Z within the next few years?
Possibly. You know what? We're all going to have to stay tuned on that one. I'm excited about what the future is bringing. You know, we've all been online and seen, you know, what it could be. You're exactly right. Unfortunately, I can't comment on anything like that.
We have the new Infinities coming, so
yeah.
Those platforms are there. And
right.
Wait, yep, right to be plucked.
Lots of rumors floating around. One thing that I can tell you is that it's going to be amazingly exciting. As you guys know, we have innovation that excites with all of our products. So, yeah, it's going to be fun.
And I don't know if you, I mean, again, it's future product, but the 370Z kind of exists in its own unique bubble. There aren't a lot of cars that are at its price point that offer a similar amount of performance. You can get something like a Corvette, which is a different level.
Right.
And you can get cars that are below it, like the BRZ, the FRS.
Absolutely.
But I was wondering maybe if the next generation 370 would be something that pushes to that next level, where we get
like up to the Corvette level.
Yeah, something like that. Not like a GTR, but kind of, you know, competing with the Corvettes of the world, competing with maybe even with the F-Type. Just not in terms of luxury, but in performance.
That would honestly, being that we're at about at the top of the line version, Nismo, being that we're at 350 horsepower now, and you know, obviously there's more that comes into play than just power, because handling wise you can stack up that vehicle against
it.
It does drive
very nice.
Yeah, absolutely. But power wise to, you know, really get that raw acceleration, you know, especially with the Vets, I mean, going all the way up to, I mean, not this current generation, but the 638 horsepower supercharged V8, are we going to get close to that? I don't want to speculate, but you know,
go ahead. And
no, we want you to please speculate. No,
on camera,
speculate on camera. Nobody will know. Nobody will know. This isn't going to air anywhere. But I mean, once again, whatever does come out, I know it's going to be very, very exciting. I really do not know the answer to what we're planning on with power wise. I know that there's been talk of you know, hybrid technology, which always, you know, helps that kind of performance boost as well.
But also raises some hackles amongst sports car purists. Yes. who are, the nice thing about the 370, like you said, it's not an overpowered vehicle. It's more about the package than about any kind of one
really
statistic.
Yeah.
So when you start throwing in hybrid technology, yes, you can achieve performance going down that route, mm-hmm. but at the same time you sacrifice some of that image, some of that pure driving feel, because by definition, right. you've got more between the driver and the road
right.
once you involve a hybrid system. So.
Absolutely. I 100% agree with you. That's why the version that we have out right now, the 14, is just sensational in its purest form, like what you were talking about, because of the fact there's no turbo, no hybrid system. It's, you know, tuned, obviously, it's breathing better than the regular version of the Z with the Nismo exhaust back there. That's obviously one of the upgrades as well. Just with that pure 350 horsepower, 276 pound-feet of torque with the six-speed manual and synchro rev match. I mean, synchro rev match is actually super exciting. That gets, you know, the hairs on my arm standing up, because that's something that you really won't find with the competition. So total package-wise, it's a blast.
Well, there's a lot for people to come and see on the Nissan booth this year, and it's
Absolutely.
Just not the typical Nissan
It's
display.
Not. We have a brand new model year 15 GTR on the other side of the display, mm-hmm. that people are going to want to check out, because it has the brand new ivory interior and the brand new Regal Red exterior paint. Right. So that's really, it's actually got 18 karat gold flake in the paint. So, yeah, it is really, really cool.
Do you have
really
a stanchion
cool.
around that?
No stanchion around it.
I wouldn't want to scratch that and bring it to a repair shop.
Yeah, right. Well, that's a solid point. But then again, you know, if I had one of those beautiful vehicles, it would be parked in the garage for weekend driving.
I understand what you're saying.
Even though you can drive it every day, it really does offer that balance of track superiority and everyday driving.
Yeah, it's large inside. You're not cramped in that cockpit.
No, absolutely not. Lots of room. Back seat, too, you know. So, whatever you need, we got it.
All right, well, once again, thanks for lending us the booth.
Absolutely.
And
yes,
for
so glad you guys came. We had an amazing time with you.
Thanks.
Yeah, we actually got to drive the Rogues last night, the new Rogues.
Oh, good.
Yep.
Yeah, how'd you guys think about it?
I drove it in Nashville.
Okay, in Nashville. Were you at the media preview there?
Mm-hmm.
Perfect.
It was great.
I was there as well. Maybe I missed you guys.
Mm-hmm.
I was at different stations throughout, so I was kind of like a ghost floating around.
Yeah, but, it was a great drive.
Yeah. With plenty of cargo versatility, seating up to seven now.
Roof.
Isn't it cool?
That's
absolutely.
That's kind of like a baby Pathfinder now. I mean, it's so different from the previous generation. You put them side by side, and it's the size difference that tells that you can tell them apart. You have that kind of homogenous look, which is nice because they're both good-looking vehicles.
Right.
But it gives, you know, it's clear when you walk into the dealership, all you have to do is decide how big your family is,
and then you pick
which one you want.
Start with the Rogue, and then you grow into.
Yeah, you've got that clear path.
Yeah.
It wasn't necessarily like that before. With the vehicle. So
absolutely, with the top trim level. It's not actually going to have that option for the third row seating. So, because then you're starting to get into the price point of the Pathfinder.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying.
Yeah, and room-wise, obviously, edge to Pathfinder. Power-wise, again, edge there. Towing capacity, that the Pathfinder's best in class at 5,000 pounds. So, it offers a lot of advantages there. And some people, you know, they really want the power of that V6, 260 horsepower. But then again, on the other side, the flip side of that coin, is the fuel economy, which is huge these days. We're best in class with the Rogue at 33 miles per gallon. So it just depends on what you need, exactly, basically what you said.
Great. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
You.
I think we're going to bring Dan back.
Okay, I'll hop out. Thank you for your time.
And I'm going to go with you.
All righty.
You're giving up your seat.
We need like music for these segments so that.
Does Moto Man have a theme song?
Just music in your mind.
Moto Man theme song. What is it?
Theme song. Oh, and it's very exciting things. Yes. We've got an official holiday song coming up. Custom written for Moto Man.
Wow. Does it have little bells in it? Ding, 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 ding,
it
ding.
Actually, it does have some bells. In the end, it does have some bells. Yes, the furniture girls wrote it. Yes.
And next up on Autobytel's live stream, it's Moto Man.
Thank you for having me, guys.
Yay, George.
Moto Man. Yeah, Moto Man. Get it straight.
Thank you. And you're wearing the Converse.
You're
not in the upscale Moto Man.
These are my...
Extreme close-up on the sneakers.
Yes, these are my studio shoes. These are the ones I wear at the Peterson when I do my inside Moto Man studio shoes.
Are they available in the gift shop?
As a matter of fact, we can make that happen. Yes.
But not with the red laces.
Not with the red laces.
And we're here to promote and commercialize Moto Man.
Yes.
So, but what about cars?
I can sell books, too. I got Carnelli Jones' book signed. I got Bob Wolf's book signed. I got them all.
M-O-T-O.
Yes.
So what are you thinking? What are you thinking of the show?
There's a lot of new cars out there.
Oh my gosh.
There's a lot of new cars. You know, it's almost like you think there's remember Detroit this past year?
Yep.
It was everything was anything you wanted to know as long as it was a Corvette. Okay? This show there's nothing that is the Corvette.
Well, the F-Type Coupe is pretty close. But I agree with you.
Let me tell you something. That car. So the way they introduced, I'm sure you guys already talked
about
this whole thing.
Yeah, we talked about the intro. Oh, my gosh.
You know, the idea of driving a car inside of a building at 83 miles an hour,
He got up to 90.
He says 83? Actually, so whoever follows me on Twitter, I lied to you. I said 100 miles an hour. So let's go with 90.
It's okay. You're in Hollywood. You can be dramatic.
That's true. I can. Yes. That's my job. Anyway, but the fact that you drove the car inside of it, how sexy is that?
Oh, my gosh.
You know?
It gives me chills just talking about it, remembering it, I go...
And then I'd like to point something out. Now, I'm a guy, so...
That's
these
okay.
guys will agree with me on this.
Maybe.
I'm a human.
Hold on.
So, before Ian came out, they brought out a beautiful XK120, and out came the lovely Fiona, who runs communications for Jaguar worldwide.
Yes.
She is the lady friend of Ian.
She is. I did not know that.
That's kind of a sexy backstory.
Well, am I agreeing to it?
There was no question.
No, we're not. You're agreeing that she was a sexy Fiona.
You mean Sir Ian.
Fiona gets out of a Jaguar SK-120 in Hollywood.
Any woman that gets out of a Jaguar in Hollywood.
And her name is Fiona.
Fiona is, yeah.
Come on, that's awesome.
Every stamp is validated.
Yes. But anyway, we're going to wait for the car.
Yeah, moving on to something that's unexpectedly sexy, at least for me, and I think for absolutely everyone who's familiar with automobiles, is that Subaru Legacy. The Legacy concept that we saw unveiled. I mean, we're not used to seeing style-first Subaru. And this is something, that, I mean, I know we saw in New York the WRX concept,
which
was good-looking, but it didn't translate. But now, I mean, I had a chance to speak to the designer of the Legacy, and he said that he fought for 2 years with engineering, and he said, look, we need to have a car that looks great and doesn't just have great viewing angles and thick A-pillars, and he said what pushed them over the edge at Subaru was the fact that Hyundai and Kia are selling so many good-looking cars at an affordable price.
Yeah.
And Subaru needed to be in the same space with them.
So much that they grabbed the grill, like the nose of the Legacy looks a whole lot like Hyundai, I think.
You think. We've had this conversation. We don't agree on everything.
There, but you said Hyundai, you just snuck it in there.
I think the question is, will it translate? Because we saw that WRX, and it was stunning. It really was. Remember how it was more like squish. You take the current car and squish it down, make it wider.
It was a sports sedan, not a compact sedan.
It wasn't a sports sedan. I would say it was like the coupe, like the Mercedes CLS or the BMW Grand Coupe. It had that look to it, but the car that came out to me looks like everything that came before.
It's an Impreza. Yes.
Where I'm concerned that Subaru will do the same thing with Legacy.
Well, I had the same concerns, and I brought this up with the gentleman whose name escapes me at this time.
Yeah.
But he said that
something sad.
Yes. The vehicle that we saw is about. It's bigger than what we'll have in production.
Yeah.
Because they wanted to exaggerate and accentuate the lines and get the concept across. But he said 70% of that vehicle is going to be in production, smaller wheels, and the same kind of curves. So that gives me some kind of hope that for once we're going to have that Subaru concept translate into reality. I mean, 70% is not a bad ratio, especially when you consider how much interesting stuff there was to look at on that Legacy concept.
Speaking of size, did you see the K900?
Yes, I did.
What do we think?
Yes. Well, it's considered, I would think, by most of us, the Equus, what Hyundai's Equus is for Kia. It's been around in Korea for a while.
It has. Do we think it's more non-Asian looking?
No, I don't think it's necessarily a question. For me, the K900, it's not a question of style. It's a question of market position. Because when you buy, if you look at how Hyundai has handled the Equus. You can buy an Equus and get the concierge service. You don't ever have to go to a Hyundai dealership and mix with the common folk. They'll come and pick up your car, do the oil change, give you an identical loaner, and you can take the badges off. And it's essentially a unique Equus-focused experience.
I did not call it Equus. Where did you get it?
It's over the border. We're going to pound.
Sorry, I'm Canadian. The pronunciation is different. It's closer to the Korean pronunciation. In any case, the K900 comes with none of that. You don't get any of that. You don't get anything special when you buy it. And you can also get a V6. So in my mind, this car is competing with, first of all, the Genesis.
What was the price point to bring it out?
60.
60, and it's based off the Equus?
Yes. Mm-hmm. It's the same platform underneath.
The Equus is 55, right?
Well, yeah, maybe-ish. I think it's right on the same.
See, I would argue that it is about the design, because the K900 to me is a little bit sexier than the Equus.
But are you going to pay that much for sexy?
Kia. Honestly, we did an episode, we were just talking about this, we did an episode like 4 years ago before the Equus hit the U.S. and we took it literally to Bob's Big Boy here in Burbank and showed it to people and said, what do you think it is? And I got responses, it was a BMW, it was an Aston Martin, it was this, it was that. But the reality of the situation is, someone that wants style is that can either pay 60 or can get a loan for 60. We'll go to 80 and probably get Mercedes.
That's a good point.
Yeah, and especially with leasing being a luxury habit, most people lease luxury cars, and then you can really play with the pricing.
Yeah.
And then you can, you know, add a lot. But I think, you know, with there's like this large car game of checkers always being played, like with the Chrysler 300.
Yeah.
And now they're kind of in between. They're in a price point, they're in between that kind of cool Avalon 300 large car thing and the $80,000 cars that we all like and want.
You know who I found is the buyer for the Equus.
This is my own theory.
Have you ever read the book, The Millionaire Next Door?
Yes.
Yes.
That is exactly the buyer for the Kia or the Equus.
I can see that.
They're buying a luxury car by the pound. They're not buying a brand.
It's a sensible choice. I like the car as well. I just don't understand Kia's, because Kia was, when Kia made its design swerve a few years ago, the idea was, okay, we're going to build more interesting to drive, sportier, exhilarating cars compared to Hyundai. That never happened. We never got those cars. The cars look great, but there's no Kia sports car. There's no equivalent of the Genesis Coupe. There's not even the equivalent of the Veloster. Those cars just didn't arrive. So the K900 as a sportier Equus, I can sort of understand that. But then you add in the V6, which you can't get with the Hyundai, so that you're kind of creating not necessarily a sportier luxury car, but a more affordable, more reasonable luxury car. It just seems like it's a confusing message to send.
I would argue that Kia went that direction because it was a very easy business case to put together. Because if you remember the Equus, they came to us when we went to the drives and everything, and they said, look, for us to make this a successful business case, we only needed to sell 2,000 cars a year in this country. K900 is the same thing. Now,
are they both sports car. Limited?
I don't know. They're probably as limited as the Equus
that many folks don't get. They don't want to sell 20,000 of them this year. It's called a scarcity play, and it's intended to make people think, oh my God, we're going to run out.
Well, it's working because
it's,
I can tell you,
basic
in Canada, they sold less than 100 last year of the Equus.
Because they can't pronounce it. That's why. They have a problem with the name of it up there. But come on, K900. Woof.
Okay, just K-900. Like Hyundai, you know that most people call Hyundai. Hyundai.
It's Hyundai like Sunday, I know.
It's Hyundai like Sunday and Monday, and now Equus. We've got... We have some other questions for you, though.
It's named after a dog.
Okay, make your last point.
I want to make this one, because you brought up a very good point. You've never seen a sports car from Kia, right? I would argue that, okay, we're going to try this one business case that we haven't done before that has made sense over in our sister at Hyundai. But I'm willing to bet you guys money that the next business case Kia tries is a Miata type car.
I would like to see that. I think that they could do a very good job.
Rear-wheel drive?
Rear drive.
With affordability.
Will it be a BRZ or will it be a Miata? I don't know.
I'll take it.
But
for how much?
Look at this. He's putting money on the table.
Okay. No, I think you're going to lose this bet, Dan, because I think Motoman is right.
I'll give you one of those Bob Lutz signed books.
Oh, yeah, okay.
And
that's cool.
If you lose, you pay for me to go to SEMA next year.
Wow.
Oh, he just
I get to pick a hotel?
Wow, this deal gets worse. This deal gets worse all the time.
Four seasons.
Yeah.
Let's get back to the show. What about hydrogen cars? There's a resurgence of hydrogen.
Yeah. I'm waiting for
Is this happening? What is your opinion? Because, you're seeing all this hydrogen again. And remember, we kind of got weary of the hydrogen thing because it wasn't going to happen.
It's funny, I have an answer for
you. Go ahead.
I was just talking with a man who's all things hydrogen at Hyundai, Mark Dipko, last night at his party. And here's why. Do you realize in the past 3 years, the number of hydrogen stations in Los Angeles has tripled? That is why.
Tripled from three to nine?
Literally. No, there are 100 hydrogen stations in and around the Los Angeles area now.
Right now?
Right now.
Right now.
Back when we were looking, remember the GM fuel cell car?
Yeah. Yes.
You had maybe 30 at that point. So I would argue that you've got Hyundai, Toyota, Honda and GM all have a product.
And Honda's never given up. They've
never
always
given up,
pushed
and neither has GM, believe it or not. They just moved it to Hawaii. So you've got this product that the technology is there, it's just the infrastructure isn't. So now they're saying, you know what, maybe we should try this, because the answer isn't, it's not 5 years off anymore, it's 3 years off.
I hope so.
But on a national scale, I mean, all well and good to have the infrastructure in California, but unless you can scale it across an entire nation, like the United States, with the population that it has, you're not going to be able to build a business case for anything more than the FCX Clarity, Honda's effort.
It will scale because with hydrogen, it's not about building pipelines. It's about local production. Hydrogen can come from every town. It comes from water and electricity. And you can make that from the sky. It can come from solar cells. It can come from wind.
So who is hydrogen's Elon Musk? Who's going to step forward and say, you know what?
I here's some seed capital. I'm going to create a national chain of individually owned hydrogen production stations.
It's not, you don't even need Elon Musk.
And we no more Elon Musk.
It's already proven.
No more.
And I say they. General Motors, Tesla, and a number of other manufacturers have proven if we sell cars in Arizona and California and see that they're successful there, we can then prove the model elsewhere.
Well, I would.
That's the precedent.
I would like for that to be true, but. I mean, we saw the Active E from BMW. We saw the Mini E.
Yeah.
And those were, they had some in the Northeast, they had some in California. They had their special markets. But then we never saw anything again.
Those
we got the i3 now, but we never got that converted version of a car that was already on the market that they tested. And these were extensive tests, 2-3 years in some cases on the leases.
My friend is driving an Active E now.
Yeah, but he didn't. I can't go buy one.
Have you driven those cars?
What's that?
I've
not had the chance.
So, okay, let's put aside the infrastructure issue or Elon Musk or whoever there is. If you've driven a purpose-built electric or hydrogen car and then a non-purpose-built electric or hydrogen car, they are two vastly different experiences. If you were to drive the one that wasn't purpose-built, you would say, I'd never want to drive one of these again. Like, you have a Leaf.
It was the same way with e-cars.
Yeah, but your Leaf drives wonderful, doesn't
yes,
it?
Yes,
because it was designed for that
But every
platform.
Other one I drove was a golf car
it was terrible.
Experience. Yeah, it was
and
terrible.
And you don't want to put a converted car in the hands of the masses. You want to give people, like Joni, a Leaf, and now she loves it.
Yes. Well, it's refined, and that's the difference.
Absolutely.
Okay. Other than the Jaguar launch, since we all are in the press and we got to go to all these launches, and really part of the whole excitement is the way they reveal a car, what other reveals did you like and we'll pipe in too? This show's reveals, like what would you say that, I know they made it rain in the Honda booth.
They had that little wardrobe malfunction with the car, I believe, as a result of making it rain. It blew. What happened was, so all this rain happened, and then there was gusts of wind associated with the water, and it blew the fabric right off the car, and the car was revealed, and then they had a team of tech lackeys run in and grab the car and put the cover back on, all hurriedly.
I'd like to say, what happened, and Chip probably remembers this, what happened back in the day, remember when, like, they used to, like, launch the Ram, and they had this, they had, like, the silk over a car that looked like a car? And then they're like, you're waiting for the silk to come back, and then boom, they drop the truck from the roof, and it crushes
Vines,
whatever underneath.
The great
I think it's probably
Tiaka.
An insurance
He's
issue.
Awesome. Yeah.
I know. It really, the launches are, you know, they had a beautiful violin and cello thing at the K9. Sometimes they bring in entertainment, and sometimes the entertainment's very odd.
Yes.
You know, very odd.
Yes, like last year's Hyundai family of musicians when they did the crossover.
So, you know,
I gotta say there was nothing that, I mean, short of, the, I think the F-Type wins the prize
I think you're
by
right.
a mile.
Yeah.
I mean, driving inside of a building at 90 miles an hour.
That was
we're agreeing
just,
90, right?
Oh, yeah, well, that's what the guy just told us.
I thought it was 80.
I thought it was 83.
Well, you didn't have your radar gun out then.
No.
Yeah.
The cool thing is you never heard the brakes. You thought it was going to stop, and then it went through the building, and it went all the way out the other end of the building. Then it stopped. So
awesome.
You never, the audience never heard the brakes.
For those of you that are watching us on YouTube, you would like to know that reveal happened right next to the YouTube space in Los Angeles.
And we're going to link to it. If you're not watching this live, we'll link to that reveal somewhere down here. We'll put a link, and you can just
give
another
click
on it.
It's on.
Or maybe just click on Dan's face all the time if you want to. I don't know what that will do in the internet world, but it might be awesome.
Here's our wrap-up question. What is the one thing everyone should see when they visit the auto show this year? If you could say one thing.
The one thing. Oh, that's
okay, say
call.
Two, three.
Okay, so the one thing that if you love video games and you love driving fast and like stupid fun things, when you come to the LA Auto Show or the other shows on a circuit down the road, go to the Ford booth and do the Focus ST driving experience thing, whatever you call it. It is one of the best
simulated.
Dan likes the hydraulically activated moves them all around because he flips
really
cars
good.
All the time.
Yeah.
So when he does that in the video game, it's just crazy.
I've never knocked wood. That's my son.
What's the one thing? You go ahead.
I, you know what? I'm going to go with the legacy concept because maybe it won't translate to the production car. Maybe this is your only chance to see a sexy Subaru.
Yeah, I have to say the F-Type Coupe just because if it truly is the new E-Type, judge for yourself. You have to see it in person because it is it's an experience to go all around the car and look at it. And it's beautiful. And also that Viper over there is just like, gosh, talk about car porn.
I'm going to say three
good
things.
Good stuff. Uh-oh. Go ahead.
Of course.
Oh, the Nissan booth.
Of course. You got to say Nissan.
Ask
Nissan
him for booth. One, you get three,
yeah,
but
of course.
That's you.
Yeah, I'm a New Yorker.
My next car, I want that. Front wheel drive.
With the manual,
the Juke. I want a
Juke.
I can't handle the Juke, Dan.
Front wheel drive Juke manual, and I want to take it to Dirtfish.
I want my three things.
Can we take the Juke to Dirtfish, please?
All right. Number one.
We're going to shut up soon.
Number one, got to go see the Shaker Hood of the Challenger.
Okay.
Number one. Number two, the toggle switch starter on the new Mini, it pulsates. The light pulsates. That's awesome. And number three, here's the shameless plug. You got to see the Peterson booth that has the F-Type next to Steve McQueen's Jaguar XKSS.
Oh, that is
How
cool.
do you like them?
Yes, that's a good one.
You're good. That's why we brought you in, man, because it's like...
Come on, stars, cars.
Boom, bada boom.
Hollywood. Oh, we're in Hollywood. The Puma. Oh, we skipped
the
that.
Puma.
This is why I love this one.
What do you say about the Puma?
If you've ever wanted, if you've ever thought the C70, Volvo C70 convertible wasn't big enough, or ugly enough, or didn't have 35-inch wheels so you could go off-roading, then the Puma is for you, because it's like they took that car, went into your nightmares, mined those nightmares of everything horrible in your life, and then created a fiberglass mold and built a car that probably weighs 3 tons.
It actually has one use for it. I don't know if you're aware of this.
Well,
I'm
sure it's
really
a good fire starter.
If you want to go to like the Borat tour of Kazakhstan, that's the car.
For $1.1 million.
It's $1 million?
Yes.
You're kidding me.
Come on, man. I thought you could afford that kind of ride.
Santa Maria, Madre de Dios.
Really?
There's also that Veloster and zombie...
It's been around like a couple of years.
Those zombies are starting to rot.
I mean,
zombies don't keep well. So
okay, that last night, Hyundai did a party where they had zombies, and that was pretty
cool. They had zombies and mermaids.
I was about to say.
And not just zombies and mermaids, but zombie mermaids.
And you see them kissing each other?
No.
What?
Damn, I missed
I didn't think zombie mermaids were capable of love. You learn something at these events. Yeah. I mean, you won't find that in your hands, Christian Anderson.
Hey, they're going to cut this out soon.
Okay.
I know. We're out of here.
They're kicking me out.
That's it.
You're out. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you for coming by.
Thank you, Joel.
Thanks.
Thanks.
Moto Man.
Oh, double. Not a mermaid zombie.
Not a mermaid. Not a mermaid zombie. That's Moto Man. MOTOMAN.TV.
Did we plug him enough?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes, and numerous other
exhausting.
Things.
So, yeah, you know, the one thing I will say is you were talking about the best of the show. It is strange to come here and see that the Viper GTS is one of the most beautiful things here. And it's, like, tucked into a corner, the far end.
It is. There's no fanfare around it. It's not up on a dais. It's not spinning. It's
yesterday's news.
Yeah, but it's absolutely stunning.
Yeah, I mean, really, the whole car show thing, it can be very practical, and you can see, oh, how do I fit in this car? But it's also just an art show. It's a beautiful, you see some of the most beautiful, and then there's where the luxury cars are. There's a new Maserati.
Right.
And, I mean, every spectrum is here.
Yes, and it didn't used to be like that. It didn't used to be that you could buy an affordable car that was also gorgeous. And we're really lucky to be living in a time that we are now. In the last 5 years, we've seen so many. Design has suddenly become part of the conversation again. You have fuel efficiency, price. I mean, that's always been there, practicality. But now, design is selling cars.
Mm-hmm.
And it's thanks in part to companies like Hyundai, who were, you know, willing to spend money on design on
they
a car
Peter
that...
They have Peter Schreier.
With, yeah, exactly. Yeah. But it's a low-margin car that looks great.
Yeah.
And they pushed a lot of other automakers along that same road, and we're lucky for that.
Yes, absolutely. Because things can get very boring and the same. And I remember Jerry Seinfeld on one of his Cars and Coffee shows saying, pointing to the cars, all the SUVs in a row and all the sedans, he goes, look how everything looks the same. Back when we were growing up, everything was completely different. So I think there is a trend.
A Lincoln Continental is not like a Cadillac.
That is right.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness.
So anyway, it's a good trend. I like the out there design we're seeing all
So I'm going to throw two things that like...
Are the impressions? Because I'm excited.
Yeah. So two things that, like, it's not flashy, but people are going to buy... I wasn't going to use a word, but I won't use that one. People can buy a lot of these. The Chevy Colorado pickup truck.
Finally,
the Tacoma has competition.
Yes.
This is extremely important for Chevrolet. Starts right away with two engines, a four-cylinder and a six. Four is a little, you know, it's going to be like the delivery vehicle. The six is 300 horse. It's pretty cool with the manual. It's going to be a lot of fun. And then the following year, we get a small diesel. Finally.
Oh, that's going to be huge. Sell like
that's huge.
Here's my question to you, Dan. Now, with that 3.6 liter V6, it's a very capable truck. And size-wise, is it large enough to be useful?
Yes.
Is the difference in fuel economy between that and a 4.3 liter Silverado enough to make someone buy it, or was it a mistake to make the vehicle so big? Because I know a lot of people that I talk to who buy
size, it's weight. It's going to be about 900 pounds lighter.
But it is about size when you're hauling stuff. I mean, I come from a family that's always had. I've had four or five pickups. My father has had numerous pickups, and we tow, we haul, we do everything with them. And you either need a truck that's big enough to do that, or a truck that's small enough to occasionally haul things and not get in the way the rest of the time. And we saw those in the 80s and early 90s. We had the Toyota truck. We had the smaller Nissan pickups. Those have gone away. They're gone. They've been gone
but
for a decade.
But they're all living in my neighborhood.
Yes, yeah. They are. You're very lucky to have the climate that you do. And you get to see these things on the road all the time. But in the north, we don't have these trucks anymore. They rusted to pieces. And you can't go to a dealership and buy them. And I'm just wondering if Chevrolet maybe missed an opportunity to offer a single cab small truck like the Ranger was, which was the last true small pickup. Or are we going to see a repeat of the Colorado's sales failures of the past because of the being the interim size and people just saying, oh, for a couple thousand more, I'll just buy a Silverado?
I think they smacked that apart.
Yeah.
So that I think they smack it out of the park, and here, so I'm going to like pivot from that because now Ford's got to do something.
Well, Ford has something like the Colorado that they sell everywhere else.
Everywhere else but here.
Yes.
But you know what? A lot of it has to do with they need to start remarketing these as lifestyle instead of
that's a really good point.
Vehicles because. People right now that are buying crossovers are the market that they need to be marketing the small pickup to.
I think that's very,
with the
very
case
true.
With the Nissan Frontier, the average buyer keeps going up in age every year that truck gets older. So it's like at 56 years old. Eventually, those people are going to die, and the people that are in their
or buy a Buick
20s and 30s,
they're for younger people now.
They will go for a crossover before they'll go for a small pickup because they don't think of it in terms of being a lifestyle vehicle
that's
that
true.
They can put their bikes in or their canoes or whatever.
And I spoke to Manny at GM Inside News, and he had the exact same philosophy about the Colorado, that it was a vehicle that's targeted for people who don't want that crossover experience,
right.
But still have the active lifestyle with all the associated gear they need to haul.
Right.
And I think that's probably why, what he excited him as well, and this is something I don't think was really highlighted at the press conference, but you can buy the extended cab truck, not the four-door, but the extended cab one, and you can get a rear seat delete, so that you end up with essentially a trunk in the car. And Allison from the editor of Truck Trend was pointing this out too. And what makes that useful is if you compare it to, say, a Ridgeline, a Honda Ridgeline, which has this trunk in the bed, that's the big thing, has protected storage, you can open it up. That's all well and good until you have a load that you're hauling along in the truck and you can't get to your trunk. So with the Colorado, with the rear seat delete, you have a trunk, you can use it, and you can also haul a load of firewood at the same time or some dirt bikes or whatever you want to do. I know we're all pausing because we're almost out of time. So I want Dan to do another impression before we leave.
All right, another impression.
Yeah, do the F-Type.
You only have a minute, Dan, so. Yeah, do the F-Type, let's hear it. What did the F-Type sound at 83 miles an hour?
No, I can't. No, it's just, it was badass.
It was badass?
That's good.
Had
to say something.
We have 30 seconds left. Do you have anything you want to tell America?
Oh gosh, just come to the LA Auto Show because it is a killer show this year. It's got something for everybody.
That's true, I think that's very accurate.
If you're thinking about buying a car in the next 3 months, 6 months, year, 2 years, go to an auto show. Go during the week. Don't go on the weekend. Go during the week when it's not crowded.
And there's no sale. It's not like going to a dealership where you have sales pressure and people always asking you questions, are you ready to buy this and that. Here you get a chance to be in the car and not worry about, you know, someone hovering over your shoulder trying to offer you financing. It's really a chance to experience the cars.
We actually have like product specialists like Chad from Nissan that we spoke with who will answer your questions. They don't follow you around.
Yeah, they're not selling you a car. No one's selling you. It's not a hard sell here.
What can we do to get you to... No, they don't do that.
Yeah.
Leave with this car tonight.
It's a place to dream about your next big purchase.
And try them on. It's like the shoe store.
Exactly. Well, we will have all of our articles about the cars that we've seen on autobytel.com. We'll have videos on the YouTube channel. You can also look at our Facebook and our Twitter. Which is facebook.com/autobytel and twitter.com/autobytel.
We'd love to hear from you if you have any comments, if you want to talk about your experiences at the show or the cars that you saw. I mean, we're here to listen to you. Just shoot it to us on Twitter or on our Facebook page, or even you can comment on the articles on the website. We'd love to hear from you.
Or share your photos on our Facebook page too.
Rant Raven, we'll see you in Detroit.
And Google Plus. Don't forget Google Plus.
And
maybe Badu, I don't know.
All right. Well, I guess that's it for now, and we'll see everybody in Detroit.
We're going to Trader Vic's. That was not a paid plug.
I'm hungry.
Okay.
My stomach is growling.